here by then.
At that moment, uh-huh. Then I give you the long forms. In the long forms, you can create the labels in the computer.
Opening is on February 1st.
What is your favorite color?
Black and white.
Black and white. Es negro y blanco. I'm here at the Watts Towers Art Center because I truly love this place. History is very interesting. Many people believe that the Art Center started as a result of the riots in 1965.
That's a lie.
The city of Los Angeles has been publishing this idea since 1999.
That's just a lie, right? It sounds all romantic, but it ain't true.
That's Cecil Fergerson, art curator emeritus of Watts. You have to get past him before you can get into this art center. He and many other artists associated with this landmark get out their photos and scrapbooks and their memories to share the stories of the Watts Towers Art Center. Simon Rodia, an Italian immigrant, spent 33 years building this amazing structure. Then he simply walked away.
1921, when he started, that was not City of Los Angeles at all. That was in the county of Los Angeles. By the time that he finished or walked away from the site in 1954, it's now City of Los Angeles. At 1765 East 107th Street, he didn't sell anything. He gave it to a friend. His structure, the Watts Towers, his land. He gave it to a friend who never called him insane. And the man who he left the work with, his name was Mr. Sorcida, lived right across the street from where the Art Center is today. And Mr. Sorcida never realized what a precious gift that was. And 6 months after he received it, I think he sold it for about $1,000, right? And the man who bought it was a Mr. Montoya.
And the Mexican family applied for some license to put a taco stand in the Watts Towers, right? Of course, when they applied for the license, now we got problems.
And what the city said publicly was we don't know what that is. We never issued a permit for anybody to do anything. And Mr. Montoya, before you can do your business, you're gonna have to clean up that property. You're gonna have to tear down the Watts Towers. He said, I don't know what it is either, but it's beautiful and I won't touch it. And he brought the deed to his exciting property home and he put it away.
1958, I was lost in Linwood, and I was looking at the map, and I thought, there's those wonderful towers. So I came over, found them, but they were open, abandoned, and I didn't quite understand. I spoke with Ed Farrell, who was an architect, and told him about these wonderful towers, which he had never heard about. We decided that something had to be done to caretake these things.
Which ticks me off because they never give the caretakers no credit. They just talk about the towers all the time. And not the people who spent all those years making sure that the towers remain there. Mrs. White across the street, a Spanish family on the end.
So we found out that the man that owned them from the neighbors was a milker in the Avalon Dairy. He wanted to sell them. So naively, Nick and I said, well, we'll buy them. Ed Farrell decided that we should build a caretaker's house or rebuild it or something, and he went down to the city to get the permission and so forth, and it found out that there was a demolition order on the towers themselves, which had been in effect since 1957, I think, but this was now late 58.
And then a group of art lovers, people who are concerned about the culture and the art, got together.
And they formed what we know now as the Committee for the Simon Rodia Towers.
And began a program designed to save the Watts Towers. That was in 1959.
And joining that committee early on was an engineer named Bud Goldstone. And
he designed a test on it, right? A stress test.
All of the officials from the city came, the engineering bureau, and the test to pull on the Watts Towers to see how strong it was.
And the towers didn't fall, right? And the rest is history. Now, different when it was just there, and it was just those of us who live in the community related to it. But now it got notoriety. That changes in America. Anything changes in America. So they needed some caretakers, right? And that's how the center became into being.
Be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
The house that had been the house of Simon Rodia, adjacent to the towers, had been burned. We constructed a platform and put a canopy over the place where the house was that was sort of translucent. And there, Lucio Krasny, and this was probably 1960, 61, was teaching the kids of the community various arts that she was involved with.
I came to the Watts Towers in the year of 1964. I was invited by a friend of mine, Noah Purifoy, to help him for a week. So I came for a week and stayed many years. I was fascinated by the ability of Noah Purifoy. He was renowned in Los Angeles as a designer and a recycling artist. Noah had this amazing ability to take something that was considered nothing in a short period of time, turn it into something valuable. And I was fascinated by that skill, and I wanted to learn how he did that. So I hung around long enough to find out.
Noah Purifoy is one of the innovators of what is known as assemblage art. In 1964, the Committee for the Simon Rodia Towers invited Purifoy to become the Arts Center's first official director. The center's current director, Rosie Lee Hooks, talked to him in Joshua Tree, California, where Purifoy's assemblage sculptures covered 2 acres.
I was pretending to be an artist, just having fun. I had my beret and wine in one hand and cheese in the other hand and having a ball.
Uh-huh.
And then I got a call from Watts that said, we want you to come out here and help us create a school for children. And so I wouldn't do anything, so I jumped at it. There was no such physical plant or anything. We had to establish ourselves from scratch. So we bought this little house on 107th Street, and that's where we started the school at. The Watts Tower Committee felt a need to occupy the minds of the children in the community. We refurbished the old house and put some chairs and tables in there for the kids to draw on.
Sure.
In 1960, I went down to the Board of Education with a classmate, and they said, we've got 2 positions. One's in the Valley, and one's in Watts. And I said, I'll take Watts. And didn't know where it was, didn't have a car, and at that time we had the Red Train, and I took the Red Train to Watts, and I have to say, it changed my life. My assignment was at Markham Junior High School, which is very close by here to the Towers. The students formed the student committee for the improvement of Watts, the letters spelled SKIFU. And so they looked around for different kinds of projects to do. They were involved in cleanup, fix-up. In April of 1965, we had met Noah Purifoy. We were coming to the towers. We decided to have a project called Operation Teacup, where we got involved in painting all the houses on the street, including the little bungalow, which was then the art center.
When I was going through my mom's things, I found this. My mother's name is Deborah Brewer.
I expect that Debbie was one of the first people that Noah invited. Mm-hmm. She was a teacher and I think one of the curators at the Pasadena Art Museum at the time. So we're bringing in all of these human resources that were each in their own way very powerful. The Teen Post program was just starting up, you see. So this became the Watchtower's Teen Post. And that supplied a salary to employ Noah Purifoy, Sue Welsh, and myself. We started out as a self-supporting operation here. They were charging 50 cents to go into the towers, and many other community groups were just offering services and finances, so we were able to make it.
Well, I'm glad we got that cleared up. By 1965, the Watchtowers Arts Center had been in operation for over 4 years.
So we were sitting about a city block away observing the whole thing and kind of enjoying it, more or less. And then the fires couldn't be put out because they wouldn't allow the fire chief to come in and with his water and stuff. And so after the fire went out, the cinders lit up the smoked up the sky.
They want to make it seem like the revolt has something to do with the towers. The towers didn't get, they did attack the towers, right? The revolt had something to do with the simple fact that all the jobs had left that community. Goodyear had moved, Firestone had moved, John Martyrs had moved, had a whole bunch of people from World War II living out there with no jobs and no way to feed their families, right? And they've introduced the welfare system to that community, and then they introduced drugs to that community.
Lives were ruined, businesses were ruined. The Watts riots, uprising, revolt, whatever you want to call it, 34 people died.
It's kind of curious, time-wise, that the disturbance came a few years after there was a great deal of activity here at the Watchtowers Arts Center. Mm. And we expected that much of it had to do with there not being too much desire to develop what was a major tourist attraction in Watts.
When it cooled off, we went out to search for whatever there is was underneath. And so that's how we found these gems, I call them. And we piled up about 3 tons of debris. Collecting these 3 tons of debris turned me on to a new art form, which we call assemblage. And it was so exciting until I kept at it until now. It's putting ideas together. And in painting, you put ideas together in color. And in assemblage, you put ideas together with objects. But a assemblage art is more visible. It's closer to home.
My mom did the sunflowers. I just remember they took these pictures forever until I guess they got it right.
The Watchtower Art Committee announced that the money had run out, and we had to look for a job. So that gave us an opportunity to assemble this debris we'd been saving up for 2-3 months. And that's how Signs of Neon came about.
Judson, I'm looking at the Sun-Times article, and there's Noah on the front page.
After the first show in 64, Noah and I went on to exhibit this collection of found objects at the campus of USC. And from there, we went directly to the National Gallery in Washington, D.C. Both Noah and I were entered into the National Registry of Artists as a result of this exhibition in Washington. And when we came back, then we started touring all of the UC campuses.
The art department didn't look upon assemblage as real art, so we were ignored. Since it generally isn't adequately cared for, it heads back to where it came from. So eventually, the 66 pieces ended up in the junk pile. And all we had left to represent those days is a little book called Junk, where we photographed most of the pieces. That's the only record we have of assemblage art done with the debris of the Watts riot.
We started a Watts Art Festival soon after the riots of Watts. And this was done primarily to let the larger community see some of the creative side of Watts. It wasn't such a bad place.
And that was the beginning of the intersection of what was going on at the Art Center, because people were going to the towers and people were coming from the park, and all of the media attention because of the police attention.
December of 1967, when there was a knock on the door, and one of the young people opened the door and said, "It's Robert Kennedy." Huh. And Robert Kennedy had come to see what we were doing, and I took him on a tour of this very small bungalow, and suddenly it was, you know, like I said, "Well, Senator, there's not much more here." And he was interested. He wanted to know, well, he asked me, "What do the people think about Lyndon Johnson?" And I said, "Well, they're not really thinking about Lyndon Johnson, Senator, but they are thinking about..." And of course, I gave him the list of the things that were important.
When we came back to prepare in the next year, in 1968, an accident happened. Noah and I were in this building on 103rd Street. One fellow came in, and Noah started questioning him. He actually showed disrespect for the man, and the man said, "Don't you come be here when I get back." And it was a tense moment between Noah and I, like, "We're going to be here when he gets back," because you don't know what he's coming back with. But sure enough, they came back. Three men came back with guns in their hands. One man pointed to Noah, "That's him." And he immediately went over and hit Noah across the mouth with the butt of his gun and broke Noah's jaw. I said, "Stop that. Don't kill him." And that startled the man that I knew him, you know. And like he said, "Okay, get him out of here then." So I was able to drag Noah out and take him to the hospital. And that day, Noah shook his head. He said, "Judson, I can't deal with these people." And he left Watts forever.
Experienced the Watts Towers through Curtis Tan and a gentleman out of Chicago named David Bradford. And that was a very fascinating and down-to-earth, by-the-shoestring kind of activity with a real interest in creative development and career development for young artists.
Thanks to a very generous donation from Anna Bing Arnold, the Towers was able to hire its first full-time director, Curtis Tan. Tan was one of the foremost enamelists in Southern California and a former jewelry designer for Renoir Matisse Limited. He also worked in batik, tie-dye, and glass fusing. By 1968, the little house was overflowing. But Bill Cartwright came up with an unusual idea to raise funds for a new building, straight out of a cereal box.
I still have the little piece of paper that out of a cereal box, you got 1 square inch of property in the Klondike. And so I thought, well, we've got some property here. Why don't we sell honorary 1 inch square inches of these things, and maybe we can get some funds that way. So it was agreed to. And we raised, I think, over $50,000.
So a half inch of the towers brought one inch mm-hmm. of land.
On honorary, yeah.
Honorary.
So
we built the center. Right.
The community built the center.
Ed Farrell, who had purchased the towers with Bill Cartwright a decade ago, was one of the architects. The other architect was Herb Kahn.
And it's amazing because there's so much wrong with it, but it's still there, right? And it's never been done away with because of codes and all that. It still functions.
The new art center opened in 1970.
We didn't have any specific hours. We were open from 8 in the morning, sometimes all night long.
Yeah.
So, but there are constant programs going on here around the clock. Mm-hmm. And I think that speaks to what one of the great differences between what is considered a local community arts center, because we take chances. We didn't have any insurance policies as such. Mm-hmm. We didn't have anything to insure, so we hung out here mm-hmm. all times of day and night, together with kids. The place is literally always open.
Tan worked closely with Bill Watts, who was also a ceramist and a member of the committee for the Simon Rodia Towers.
Bill Watts, you know Mother Watts, the concrete figurative work that sits out in front of the Watts Towers Art Center? Well, he did that with a class of his.
Back in 1968, there was a group of artists that actually, when they started to develop the Mother Watts piece, and to build a large thing like that, they had never done that before. Mm-hmm. And that's concrete.
Watts modeled the sculpture experiment for his class on the work of European sculptor Henry Moore.
Mother Watts is made with an armature of rebar and other metal parts all wired together because he wanted the students to know that Simon Rodia never welded anything.
I had actually never worked with concrete in that particular manner, so I was quite impressed with what they had come up with. It's still standing today as a testimony to the strength.
And the children have been painting Mama Watts for years. So if you go out and you see her today, Mama Watts always has a different dress, has a different appearance, depending on the students that are taking classes here. So Mama Watts has evolved through the years and is ever-changing and yeah. still will change.
Then, in 1975, there was a major shift.
The building that we know now as the Watts Towers Art Center mm-hmm. was actually a donation to the city of Los Angeles, like the entire property was, from the committee for the Simon Rodia Towers in Watts that raised money to build the art center. So the city of Los Angeles benefited a lot.
The center's first director under these new arrangements was the sculptor John Outterbridge.
I think art as an act, as a process, is something that belongs to the human potential. Just that need to express, that's what it is. And it can result into anything. It sings, it dances, it produces scientists, right? Nature does it. Thunder is symphonic, you know. Erosion in the mountains is sculptural in nature.
When I became about 13, 14 years old, I was hanging out with the wrong crowds, basically doing things that I shouldn't have been doing. And Mr. Outterbridge offered me a job to come in an afternoon to clean up the center after the night classes.
My history had been the inner city Boston in the mid-60s. It had been Africa and Peace Corps. So John came, saw my artwork, we sat, we talked, and he said, I want to show you something. And he put me in his car and he drove me out to the towers. And I absolutely fell in love with the magic of the towers, and he said, you know, I need someone to help me with the education here at the center when we open the doors. And that's from the city point of view. It's not opening the doors from the history of the center.
Well, Mr. Outterbridge needed somebody to come in and help hang the walls that separated the gallery from the office spaces. Since that's what I went to school and got trained for, I came in and assisted in building the walls.
John was opening up the towers. Since John and I were hanging, we're good friends. He asked me to be a part of teaching wood carving. So I ended up working here for about 12 years, moving things around. I had the unique opportunity in teaching here, but also teaching off-site at my studio space.
And then a couple of years after that, they wanted to build a loft for another office space. Well, I had trained in steel, drywall and paint, so I came in and assisted with that.
And I was new in town, and I got this wonderful being named John Outterbridge on the phone who said, come down. And what I found was that the towers and the center were simultaneous, but they were different. And there was just a wealth of love. And he was bringing in artists who had visions to come and work in the community. And he was also embracing the notion of music in the community and celebrating that notion.
Started here when I was like about 13, 14. I'm 42 now.
This is Dean Dressing. You know her? She used to teach classes at the center. She don't look like that anymore because she had a very terrible motorcycle accident. And when she became conscious, she said, anybody come to see me? And they named her some dyke people. And she said, well, that's my family. So.
And poet Elliot Pinckney.
Okay. You're asking about my connection with the towers? It began with John Outterbridge, and it was a twofold connection because not only did I get a chance to meet John at the towers, he also gave me the opportunity to do my first mural. That's how I got into murals, because of John. Community art sort of developed by the mural artists. We didn't get a lot of exhibitions from a lot of galleries and a lot of museums. And so it's making a statement to the people where the people could see the art. They can comment on the art. The art influenced the people and the people influenced the art. So it became a collaboration between the both of them.
The Art Center began to spread outside its colorful walls. Art teachers from the Los Angeles Unified School District came to the towers to train, and Operation Go-Kart established a mobile art gallery in the Compton Avenue School.
In the mid-70s, we literally put up a professional gallery in the school. When schools came, they'd bring 100 kids and we'd roll out the craft paper on the floor, and 100 children at a time would be making masks or making something that reflected the joy of Simon Rodia and his towers.
And there was music, music, music.
It only happens once a year, and it only happens in Watts, California.
I remember this Kylo. I remember, man, that cat was out. You know, I remember he would come into the gathering, man, and lay under the grand piano during the concert, the whole concert.
But see, those were the kind of audiences that came with Black Eyed Peas, because we had collard greens and sweet potatoes in the kitchen at that time.
We were doing a music in the park, a lunchtime music, and unfortunately I was the only musician to start it, and I would collect power from the local station there and put my piano in front of the fountain and start playing. After a month or so, musicians started to coalesce, and from that sprang the Watts Towers Jazz Festival. We decided to put together a music festival that would occur one day in Watts Towers and the next day in Leimert Park. The first organized Watts Towers Jazz Festival occurred in 1978. Alonzo and I brainstormed a lot about how we could pull this off. He didn't have any money, I didn't have any money. So we looked at what resources we had available. I think Alonzo said, well, John Outterbridge works for the city. Do you think that we could get some support? We went to John, and what he was able to pull was $300 out of his budget and our access to the mobile stage.
And the mobile stage.
And that mobile stage set the foundation for the whole festival. Wherever it was, we had a festival.
Often the music that was produced or that came out of this experience went somewhere else for other audiences, but not for the audiences of the community that gave birth to that energy and those artists slash musicians.
I was here for the original festival that they gave, which was held just in our little parking lot, with a little trailer that came from the city with a couple of little bands from the area.
Pete Escobedo and his orchestra!
When I see Tootie.
And Etta James.
When Yango.
Hal Lamb.
The Buddy Collettes.
Sandra Wheeler.
Billy Higgins.
The Pancho Sanchez's.
Najiri.
Mr. Al Rodriguez.
Johnny Otis.
The serious Roger Spott.
Nate Morgan on piano.
Esther Phillips.
Barry McCord.
Keyvon Walker.
Margie Evans.
Johnny Reeves.
Ernie Andrews.
Barbara Martha.
Bernie Poole.
Harmonica Fats.
Tapscott would have to be most instrumental because without payment, Horace was always available. He always closed the festival with his orchestra, and he would close it with his very popular Lift Every Voice and Sing, the Black National Anthem. It was the theme for our festival, and it was a political theme.
That particular poster was done in pastels. A lot of times when you're doing community arts, you don't have a large budget, and we basically were robbing Peter all the time to pay Paul, and we basically worked magic with our budgets, and this was the first time we actually had a sizable amount of money to work with and were able to do full color and to actually celebrate the kinds of musicians and the kinds of things that were going on at the center. This was a black and white, which is much, much cheaper to do, but we were trying to put out documentation so that people would know that the center was here, because we knew that at some point people would want to know what actually happened here.
Charlie Mingus had enough history and watched to be honored. So I got with an artist named Carlos Cobbs and I created the Charlie Mingus Award. And that year, I gave 25 people the Charlie Mingus Award during the festival. because some of the real giants of jazz were still living, like Philly John Jones, Papa Joe Jones, that drummer, what's his name, Jewish fella, Shelly Mann, was still living there. In fact, he died the Monday after the festival. And somebody called up and said that they didn't want to be known to the public that the last place he performed was out in Watts. And I didn't know about that, because if I knew about it, everybody knew about it, right? But they hushed it up, right?
Watts. At one point in time, when you said Watts, it was always something negative associated with it. Now we know people have been coming here, as I said, for over a decade. I even noticed that there are a lot of people from other ethnic communities beginning to come to the festival. I've done about the last 12, 13, 14, I'm not sure, and I see a greater participation.
And I had this idea that I put before the group about a festival of drums that would focus on the fact that we don't know cultures in the world that do not have a drum of some sort. And at that time, Jimmy Solanke from Nigeria said, "The heart is a drum. We all have this beating thing in us, and it would be significant if we could bring the cultures together and have everybody bring a drum."
We played drum circles everywhere. Venice Beach, Griffin Park, wherever we could get drum circles together. But there was no collective idea to bring the elders together with the young people and play drums. This started in 1982, the first Watts Drum Festival, which at the time was quite an event that had never happened. And the first one was very powerful. It started off as a very spiritual experience. It started off as an experience of doing the ritual of acknowledging the elders of the community, the African ritual of growth and prosperity. From then to now, there is no real resemblance, except that it was the day of the drum festival, but there is no resemblance. This is the most diverse environment that I have seen, a very rich mixture of ethnicity, a very rich mixture of focus, a lot of acceptance, a lot of peacefulness, a lot of spirituality, and a lot of spirit.
Wow, man, this is the 8th annual Watts Towers Day of the Drum Festival.
Like earth, what seeds are planted determine his work. The cultivation of your...
In 1989, the center offered a home to the beautiful instruments that had been collected by Dr. Joseph Howard and his wife, Bootsy. One of the most memorable art openings of the mid-80s was the Jonathan Leonard exhibition of African-American Folklorica. This was a moment when we had to decide what art meant to us, rather than letting someone else decide that for us.
John Leonard had one of the greatest collections in the world. Croton was a general manager then. So he wouldn't do the invitations out because he thought it was too stereotyped with the black woman, you know, hanging the clothes on the line, you know. I took it to the Times and got Susan Mikey to write an article that you can't censor the arts.
The Watts Community Action Council feel that we play a most vibrant part of the growth and development of this community center. The Watts Community Action Council is just what it said, an action council. We had to demonstrate against Cultural Affairs.
Forced them to mail invitations out. And then the day the show opened, as we got all this press, hundreds of people came to because that's America, you know. You stir up crap and get a lot of people.
I hate to bother you, but I need a hand with Amira. The dance class is about to start.
All right. You know, I'd be there doing some work, but in the middle of it, I could stop and pull out a flute and go over and start playing my flute while I'm on the clock. It's a sacred space in that way, you know. Watts Towers was the cultural center of Los Angeles for us. If something wasn't happening there, there would be pretty much nothing happening in Los Angeles on a consistent basis where people could gather. John Eric Priestley, K. Curtis Lyle, Quincy Troupe, Ojenke, Blossom Powell, even Elaine Brown, and I think even Wanda Coleman. It was a very significant point for black writers to come together, and that's where we came to present our work. All the different artists would come together and impact on an art piece. You know, how a program became an art piece. Houston Conwell did this piece. Asanga, Charles Dickson, there were a few more artists. They did this a performance piece, you know, right. And they had made artifacts for this, and they washed mm-hmm. my feet and sent me to Africa with these bags of Watts soil. And I ended up being on a national stage in Somalia, 2,000, 3,000 people in the audience presenting their officials with this soil from Watts as a gesture.
And if a newborn baby comes out looking like 2 pounds of soggy grapes after a nuclear reactor meltdown, and if you find yourself radioactively depleted, invaded, bombed out, borderless, dislocated, delinked, watch out. You're in the globalization domination process. Now, what's your take?
One of the important elements at Watts Towers these days is found right next door in the Watts Towers Art Center. Founded back in 1961, it serves not only as a true community center, but also as a focus point for the arts. For example, just about every day, the center is filled with visiting school children from all over Southern California. Children who have come to see the world-famous towers and then get a little hands-on experience at creating their own art. Simon Rodia's dream is still very much alive. Right in the middle of Watts.
I was on site one morning at about 5:30, and there was a state surveyor, a young African-American man surveying the region, and he said, "We're looking at the building over there. We're going to buy the property." And I said, "Are you going to tear that down?" He said, "Normally, that's what we do, because we're going to park state vehicles there." I said, "Wait a minute, man. Let me go get you a stack of stuff." So I went and got him a stack of program materials and came back. And he said, "Wow, so let me present this to the people who make the decisions at a state level." And they called me 2 weeks later and said, "We know what we think we might be able to do with you and that property. We could let you use it for $1 a year. How is that?" And I went to the city of Los Angeles after they told me that, and got the city's architect involved, who was Forrest Scott, and
The city worked it into the program, and that building is still there today.
For I was a heron shy, a swallow full of sky, trilled by the fire spark, meadow lark, a grain of sand that grew into a stone, a breath of air, and for I was a bone, I was a shadow, a protozoa, riffa, rasa, linta, rata, plata, minti, asca, minti, maca, and yoda, mata, mollus, canilla, do, anthropodo, integumenta, recordata. Remember me.
John Eric Priestley, he had been put out of an apartment building in East L.A. that he couldn't afford anymore, and we had to break into this building to get his stuff out, and slid down to the side of the wall into the truck with his belongings. And I took him to that building, which was in our possession for a week and a half or something like that, and it was empty. And that's where he set up housing, and he's still there till this day. John Eric Priestley's presence to the building set the tone for an artist in residency program at the Watchtowers Arts Center.
Remember me, my flag, it purple flowers flat, forget me nots, my color, and foes of bone, I was a shadow.
We discovered in having the needs that we had, the process of art had not only a pulse, but it had a kind of audacity to be anything that it needed to be at a given time. Mm-hmm. That it wasn't something that hung on a wall, something that performed from a stage. It was the essence of life.
Right.
It was very necessary for us. Mm-hmm. And so art took another place, stepped out of a frame, and became very, very, very visible and useful.
Then, after 17 years of really being in the moment at the Towers, director John Outterbridge left to return to his personal artwork.
I am a peace builder. I pledge to praise people, to give up put-downs, to seek wise people, to notice and speak about hurts I have caused, to right wrongs. I will build peace at home, at school, and in my community each day.
Change was rolling in, but with it came troubled and challenging times. John Outterbridge was replaced by veteran photographer Willie Middlebrook.
For my shovel, my project was to, and because I'm a visual artist, I wanted to create a piece about seeing. And also I wanted to use image of the Watts Towers. So what I did was I chose a photograph of the Watts Towers that I had taken 30 years ago.
Willie actually grew up in the towers, practically. Willie was the image that the city really wanted to see. They kind of wanted someone to look like, I don't know, I guess they wanted John again.
But the change in administrative styles caused friction. Middlebrook was terminated 6 months later.
It's not racial, now it's body demographics. So I didn't feel that that was right. So I actually picketed the Watchtowers with a group of friends. And it was quite dramatic because as people were coming in, we were telling people the story, walking up and down the line, and people were wondering, should they cross the picket line? And it was, and we started chanting, and it was really one of those very emotional things. They couldn't fire him. They did take care of him, and litigation, he had to be paid, and all those kinds of things. They don't want to talk about that because that's a big no-no in political uprightness.
The position then went to Mark Greenfield.
We probably are in the midst of the most creative community in the world. People have to think creatively when they get up every day here. The kids have to think, how do I survive through this day?
I don't know that there was a time that I recall first being an artist, but I think I recall the time I first remember being drawn to the arts more than ever before. And it had to happen during the 92 uprising. I was about 13 or 14 years old, and I just remember being at home alone and just having this great feeling of frustration. And I didn't know how to express that other than through art. And I had had a lot of art training and been through a lot of art classes, but I guess I'd never really had an appreciation for them until that moment. Now, as an art instructor, I see some of the kids in the neighborhood. They're in my classes, and it's the same classes that I used to take when I was a kid. And it's just so much fun having, you know, the kids in the neighborhood take the classes, seeing them grow up the way that I did.
Today's unsung hero knows that kids love comic books, and so he uses them to teach kids about life's important lessons.
He ends up in jail.
Okay, we'll do one story where...
Brown runs a free workshop for children at the Watts Towers Arts Center every week.
It started out after the Los Angeles riots in 1992, and as my part, I created a comic book superhero, and I wanted to show kids there was other ways of dealing with conflict and violence.
Then he got the kids involved. He started holding workshops, and together they published Tales from the Kids, a comic book drawn entirely by kids. The stories are about staying away from gangs and drugs and settling confrontations peacefully.
My name is Roger Hamilton Spots, and I am a musician, composer, arranger type. And among other things, I had the fortune or the blessing to be the first president of the Friends of the Watts Towers Arts Center.
Well, the Friends of the Watts Towers was a big challenge when I first got here. The organization had been dead for about 10 years. And when I first got here, realizing that we had to have a support group, I started investigating different ways of possibly getting it revived. I came to find out that there was an $18,000 lien against the Friends. And there was we have a permanent collection of African masks from Augustus Hawkins that were donated to the center, and there was a lien against that collection. So one of my challenges was to try to figure out a way to get through some of the bureaucracy to get the penalties on the Friends forgiven and get us reinstated. And that process took about 2 years. Who had worked at the center as teachers, administrators, volunteers.
Now this invitation might lead you to believe that the center was 25 years old, but it left out those early years before the city got involved. So it was really the 34th year of the Watts Towers Art Center.
Oh, the war exhibit. Singularly the most difficult time of my life. Alex Donis. He was on staff here and was a teacher here for about 2 years. Basically what he did is he did large paintings, in some instances drawings, of police officers dancing with gang members. Police officers and gang members have been dancing together for years on many levels. They almost need each other. But the way that he chose to characterize it in some instances suggested some homosexual situations. Some of the community mavens who came through here saw it and went ballistic. They told me, in no uncertain terms, you take that down or we're going to take it down for you. The wedge that this would have driven between the center and the community was more than I wanted or anybody in cultural affairs wanted. And so the decision was made jointly between myself and the general manager to take the exhibit down. I consider anything that stimulates a necessary dialogue to be valid and important. But I think I misread the community. I don't think the community was ready for it. And they may, you know, it may be years. By the time the community gets to the point where it would be ready for it, it may be an entirely different community. You know?
No, 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 la visa.
No, 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 no,
I came to the center in August of 2002. I was interim director with John Outterbridge right after he left, and also right after Willie Middlebrook left. And now I'm back again, and I'm loving it.
We have a great future in what we do here. And it's challenging when people don't understand the culture divide. We shouldn't have to go out of our community to enjoy the beauty and the artistic participation. We should be able to do it here.
The murals that I painted on the Compton Avenue School wall and the wall back behind this building are still there. They have not been destroyed by the community. They still exist, and this is from the late 70s until 2004. So I think we have to really be aware of the power of the arts within this community.
When we talk about Fertile Ground, we talk about love, life, and the legacy that we'll leave.
It's like the world without the stars. Watts couldn't be without the Watts Towers Arts Center. We're a star. You go for that?
This really is fertile ground.
For me.